Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. Today I'll be showing you how I made this classy halter neck top. I found it on Pinterest a while ago and I fell in love with it. Personally, I love halter necks and feel like it's one of them styles that suit a lot of people. I would say this top is more on the formal slash evening wear side, and I think it would look really cute with some smart pants and heels. I had the perfect fabric for this, which I've been sitting on for multiple years now, so I was excited to put it to use. I don't really know what the fabric is called though. I want to say gorgette, but I'm not certain. So the photo that I had of this top only showed the front, and I was trying to think about how I'd get into it. I knew I definitely didn't want a zipper, just because I feel like it takes the delicateness away from the design, and finding an invisible open-ended zipper is a nightmare. So after much thinking, I finally realized I can make use of the shirring technique to act as a stretch factor in the back of the garment. Once I had my sketch mapped out, I went on to drape him. First, I used some drape tape to map out my design lines, which made it so much easier to drape. Now, when it came to placing the fabric, I did not know how to start, but I got there in the end. My goal was to get a nicely fitted bodice, which is waist length, and I managed to achieve this, and then I had to use a separate piece of fabric to add the halter neck feature on. Then I taped the pieces together using the drape tape and outlined my markings. Then I took the drape off the mannequin and refined the pattern with my rulers. Then I repinned it onto the mannequin, and then I felt like I was happy with it all, so I turned it into a digital pattern. Now it's time to sample, so I printed my PDF pattern, which is available on my Etsy page, the link's in the description box. The easiest way I find to assemble the pattern is by using a trimmer to cut the edges of every other page of the pattern, and then use sellotape to stick them together. Then just cut it out using scissors. Once that's done, I can start the first sample. I don't have much sample footage because this is where I got most of my trial and errors out the way. There were two things that I needed to change, one being I made the back pieces too long. I accidentally included part of the dart measurement, but that was an easy fix, and the other was the bust dart. I found that it made the bust too pointy, so I reduced it by about 2 centimeters. I also decided I want to line the garment because it wouldn't look right if the straps for the halter neck were hemmed, so I felt like lining was the only option. I could have done a half lining where it stops halfway in the garment, but I didn't want any weird bumps, so I decided to use two fabrics for the lining, as I thought the main one would have been too thick. After I made those changes, I felt happy enough to cut my real fabric, so I went ahead and did that. Make sure you mark all your pattern information, like the darts and the notches, and match the grain line with the grain of the fabric, because this can affect how your garment comes out if you don't. Most times when I'm assembling a garment, I start off with the darts. To make sure I sew them properly, I like to pin them and make sure the pin is going through the marks I made on both sides of the fabric. Then I take it to the sewing machine and make my stitch a little bit closer together than usual. I start from the side seam with a reverse stitch and then slightly curve the stitch into the bust when I get to the end. Also, don't backstitch at the end of your dart to avoid creating a pucker. Instead, tie your threads off by hand with a little bit of slack in it. I did the same thing to the lining, but if I was to do it again, I would assemble the lining pieces first to create the full front lining and then sew the darts. You'll see why in a bit. Once I finish sewing all the darts, I press the seams with the iron. I like to iron the lining dart and the main fabric dart in opposite directions to reduce the bulk when we put the pieces together. I also decided to do a top stitch in detail on the lining because I think it looks nice and it also helps the dart to lay flat. Whenever I do top stitching, I extend my stitch so that it's not too close together, and this was the result. Next, I put the lining pieces together. So we're working with curved seams. This is why earlier I was saying I'd probably do this seam first next time before I do the dart, to avoid having to sew a curved seam, just because they're a little bit more troublesome, although it wasn't that hard to do. You just have to ease the pieces into each other. The best way to do this is pin both ends of the pieces together, pin the middle, and then ease the rest of the seam into each other. Then I just sewed both sides with a straight stitch, and I forgot to mention I'm using a 1 centimeter seam allowance on my pattern. Next, I went to press the seam, but because our seam was curvy, we need to release the tension to allow it to lay flat. So just carefully make a few snips into the seam allowance, but make sure you don't cut your stitches, and then iron it flat. Be conscious about which way you iron your seam allowance. I ironed mine with the main fabric facing down because I wanted to top stitch the other color fabric. And this is what the top stitching looks like, and I'm very happy with it. Now we're going to assemble the center front of our garments. On the pattern, there was a notch mark to indicate where we should stop slash start sewing. So I matched my pieces and pinned them to that mark. A trick to make sure your seams always line up is to poke the pin through the seam and make sure it comes through the stitch on the other side. Similar to how we did the dart, that's how you know that your sewing is accurate. I pinned the main fabric in the same way and took it to the sewing machine, again with the 1 centimeter seam allowance. Now we're giving the front a break and moving on to the back of the top. So now we're on to the shirring. I'm prepping my piece by marking my seam allowance. I added 1 centimeter initially. I added 1 centimeter initially, but then I decided I might need 1.5, and then I ended up trimming off the extra 0.5 centimeters and sticking to 1. When you're shirring, you want to do a rolled hem because you can sometimes see the underside of the garment when shirring because of the gathering that we get at the top and bottom. So I used a rolled hem foot to be accurate with this, and marking your seam allowance line makes this such a breeze because you know you're being accurate with your sewing. I'm not gonna lie and say this was easy, because it wasn't. My fabric was fraying like crazy. My fabric kept slipping out of the loop in the hemming foot, and I just wanted to pack my machine away, honestly. But what's a project without a bit of frustration? So after I finished hemming, I did have a few spots that didn't hem properly, so I unpicked and redid them, and then carefully used a lighter to seal the fraying edges. Once that nightmare was over, I moved on to shirring. I have a tutorial on my channel where I made a shirred maxi skirt, so if you want a more in-depth tutorial on that, then you should check that out. But for now, I'm gonna assume you know what to do. So I just changed my stitch settings and bobbin to an elastic one and started sewing. It didn't take too long because the back is quite small in length. Once I finished, I gave it a light steam with the iron. This just tightens everything up, and I'm really happy with how the shirring came out. Now we can attach the side seam pieces, right sides facing, and just sew with a straight stitch. Then for the lining piece, I pressed the seam allowance towards the back because I wanted to top stitch it, and I ironed the main fabric piece seam allowance open to help the garment lie as flat as possible. Now it's time to trap the shirring piece between the back side lining pieces. To do this, I placed the shirring piece right sides facing the right side of the garment and pinned both the side seams with the lining piece on top. So essentially, the shirring is trapped in the middle of the main fabric and the lining. Then I pinned it up and around the halter neck, which took some time because the tie is quite long. When you get to the crossover point of the halter neck, just make sure the seams align with each other and stick a pin in it. I'll explain the sewing bit for this when we get to it, but don't worry, it's not hard at all. Now set your machine to your normal seam settings and make sure your thread is back to the normal thread, and start sewing from the side seam, working your way towards the halter neck tie. When you reach the top of the halter neck, you're going to want to do a pivot stitch, which is where you keep your needle in the fabric, pick up the presser foot and turn the fabric 90 degrees in this case. Then continue until you reach the other corner and repeat. Then just work your way back down the tie, and now we're approaching the crossover. So for this bit, you want to slow your sewing right down and carefully sew until you reach the stitch for the center front seam, then backstitch to secure it in place. This needs to be really controlled, as you don't want to stitch over this line, otherwise it'll cause a ripple on the outside of your garment. So just try and get as close as you can, as carefully as you can, and repeat this for the other side of the halter neck. I also added in my label to the lining at this stage. Now that's done, we can trim the seams. This is to reduce bulk and make our garment lie much flatter. I did something called grading the seam, which is when you cut one side of the seam allowance only, rather than trimming it all. This was because I didn't want to risk the seam coming undone, and to prevent the marks that come when you're ironing raised parts of a garment. Make sure to snip the corners of your ties like this, so we can get a nice pointed edge when we turn it out. Then I just flipped the garment right sides out, and at this point I just felt relief because I honestly didn't know how I was going to assemble the lining to this top. I was just winging it, but sometimes you just gotta do that. Thankfully it worked out in the end. Now that was out the way, the last step is to hem. For this bit, we have to pin the lining and the main fabric together, right sides facing. And to do this, we have to trap the whole top inside. So I started to pin the edges together on both sides, and then I matched up the center seams and continue pinning. To turn the whole garment back out, we need to leave a small opening to pull everything back out, so make sure you don't fully pin it closed. And also, you know that means we've got a bit of hand stitching to do. So once you've done that, take it to your sewing machine and sew it closed. Just don't forget to leave that opening. Make sure you backstitch at the start of the opening, and when you move to the other edge, make sure you backstitch again to ensure the seam doesn't unravel. Now pull the insides out through that hole carefully and pin it closed with your chosen seam allowance. Now we can move on to the hand stitching. We're going to be doing an invisible hand stitch, so we're just working on the inside of the seam allowance going in and out. Try not to make your stitches too long or far apart, otherwise we'll have a gappy hem. If you're really not up for hand stitching, you can just take it to your sewing machine and do a straight stitch, but you know, after all that hard work, like, let's just continue to get our garment looking pristine. But once that's all done, we're completely finished, we can press the garment and get it looking crisp, and here's the final reveal. So that brings us to the end of the video, guys. I hope that you enjoyed it. Also, I want to mention that I don't know if you noticed, but I started the whole garment again. Basically, I wasn't too happy with the dart placement, so I decided to change it and move it so that it's at the crossover point, just below the crossover point, and we've got like a center front dart, and it just makes the garment fit so much better. I also eliminated the side piece here, so the front kind of just flows nicely into the back. It's just one piece and everything else is the same. I guess it just eliminates a lot of sewing and a lot of time, so there's not really much top stitching that you'll need to do for the lining. It's only the dart really. So yeah, it makes quick assembly. Also, I decided to line it with the same fabric, one because I was being lazy, but it just ended up being better. Like, it just matched. I don't know how to explain it, but with using this one, the one that's in the video, it was like it's a very tough kind of material. I didn't really like it that much, so I think like it just made for less movement, whereas the final piece with the same main fabric and lining, it just flows better. I don't know how to explain it. But yeah, the assembling of the garment is still pretty much the same. In fact, it's less work now, so it's easier to do. The pattern's being digitized and graded from a UK size 4-16, and it's available to download on my Etsy page, and I'll put the link in the description box down below. Also, I don't know if you noticed, but you can wear the top two ways. So this is one way with just the straight crossover, like how I drew it in the picture. But in the final reveal, I wore it by just doing like a double twist. So I twisted it again and then just tie the knot at the back. And you know, I really like it like this. Like, I really prefer it like this. I hope you guys enjoyed this video as much as I enjoyed making it, and I hope to see you next time. Bye guys.